So let's talk about the third and final piece of our exploration into bug elimination today. It's called software composition analysis, and that's checking the fully assembled product for known risks. So we'll talk a little bit about in the intro here, what's open source, what's third party, first party, how do all these bits of code come together to make a fully assembled product? And we'll talk about, are there any problems with that we have to be aware of or concerned with? And then, of course, we'll see how that fits into the development lifecycle of software. And we'll talk about some different techniques for this one, just like we did in prior modules. And again, we'll see what the ROI for that really is. So here we have a pie chart, and we've got this very small slice. That's the code we write. Then we've got a slightly larger part, and maybe that's the components and pieces that we wrote before, that we bought third party. Then we have this very big piece of the pie, and that's basically open source code. And it makes sense that we have that. That's great. It's a fantastic thing. You don't want to find yourself reinventing the wheel. You don't want to find yourself rolling your own crypto, writing OpenSSL from scratch. You're going to absolutely mess it up. Don't do that. You want to use open source components. So it's a good thing in many ways. But there are some hidden costs. There are some drawbacks that we need to be aware of. For example, the common vulnerabilities and exposure, the CVE, is a list and database of the known vulnerabilities for all the products that are out there. And if we're using OpenSSL, like so many other people are, you bet that attackers are going to try and find vulnerabilities in it. So this basically puts a huge target right on our back. If there's a vulnerability in that product, we've got a vulnerability in our product. And so how do we deal with that? How do we keep up with that? That seems like a lot to, do we have to follow every day, every week, every month? We have to check every product that we've ever assembled and used? Kind of, yeah. It's a little bit daunting. So look at this image here. We see that all these little rivers flow into this bigger lake. So we've got the first party code, third party. Then we start introducing other things, maybe some out of date code, vulnerable code we didn't know about is also in our product, some outsource code development that maybe came from a party that doesn't have as quality practices that we do. Maybe there's copy-paste stuff in our code we didn't even know about, unauthorized, unlicensed code. Again, many of these larger software products are assembled from many, many, many different other smaller projects. And so we have this essentially floodgate of, now here's our product, it's ready. Somebody has to sign off on this and say, this is our fully assembled product, and it's as safe as we know how to make it. We did static code analysis, we did fuzzing, and we need to check and make sure all of these other components are safe as well. And that's what this is all about, this composition analysis. Let me give you a little image here. This is not meant to scare you or anything like that, but if you take a look at a big piece of software, and let's say 2008 it was released and it had a whole bunch of different components in it, and it didn't have any or very few vulnerabilities. Ideally, you shouldn't be releasing software that has any known vulnerabilities. Well, over time, if you did nothing with that, you just left it out in the field, and that happens quite a bit, especially for software that unfortunately wasn't originally intended to be connected and updated as often. You think about industrial or whatever it may be. If you leave that out in the field for 7 years in this case study, now you've suddenly went from very few or no known vulnerabilities to literally hundreds of vulnerabilities that are known. So all an attacker has to do is figure out that, oh, they use this old version of whatever. I already have a vulnerability. I already have a working exploit for that. Let me just launch this. So software decays over time if you don't take care of it, if you don't care and feed it. Like anything else in life, if you're going to have something, you got to take care of it. And that's true of software as well. So we have this idea of a software bill of materials. And that's knowing that, okay, how do we figure out what's in our product? Well, we could do this manually. We could keep a list, and we probably should to some extent do this. Of every piece of software, we use this version of OpenSSL, this version of whatever, this version of regular expression, doesn't matter, all these different products. And that way we know what the versions are, and we can keep an eye on, are there any vulnerabilities known for those? And if there are, we know that we need to do something about that. We know that we need to fix that. And hopefully we integrated those products in a way that we can actually make that fix. Sometimes I've seen projects where they kind of just stole chunks of code, put it in, and they lose track of what versions they had, and it's really hard for them to make the fixes. The thing can get out of hand in a hurry. So what can we do to help with that? We can do this thing called software composition analysis. And I'll talk about, again, more what the techniques are and exactly how this works. But let's first see that it's useful to more than just development teams. So think about like IT, corporate security, purchasing, all the parts of your corporation, they can use this. Your product security can use this, obviously, because what they can do is this software composition analysis is a black box technique where give me your fully finished product, whether it's source code or binary or a zip file or whatever it is, I'll scan it, I'll let you know everything that's in it, and I'll let you know if there's any vulnerabilities in it, and I'll keep track of all that for you too, so you don't have to worry and stress and lose sleep over maybe I should go and check those CVE websites again today and see if there's any new vulnerabilities in my product. So the product security team is definitely going to want to do that for the stuff that you write as a company. Other parts of your company might want to do this too. Your purchasing department may want to do this to see what third-party products are in for purchasing decisions, maybe negotiations, who knows what. Your corporate security is definitely going to want to do this. As they look at buying other software from other vendors, they're going to want to check and see, are these folks following best practices? And of course, your legal team, you know how legal teams are, they're definitely going to want to look over everything to make sure all the licensing agreements are correct and all the, you know, intellectual property rights are in the right place. So there's a huge use for this SCA. So how does the workflow operate? Let's take a look at this. So you've got a policy that says this is how we're going to write software, this is how we're going to use software, we're not going to use any, you know, certain type of licensed software, whatever it may be, you've got some policy. Then you can scan the code and see, well, okay, so here's the code and this is what's inside of it. That gives you your bill of materials. From there, you can identify, this software does actually have a few well-known vulnerabilities. We're going to need to update that code, recompile it, whatever needs to be done. And that allows you to take the rest of the steps in this SCA workflow to identify and secure and make your software as safe as you possibly can and fully integrate that. Because one of the great things about SCA is that it's very easy to integrate this into your overall development process. It lends itself well to continuous integration. It's not something you want to do manually. So the pros are that you gain visibility. It's easy to identify those third-party products with SCA. You get detection. You can find vulnerabilities that you might not even know about. You might have used stuff you didn't even realize that had old versions. You get the confidence to use open source without having to stress whether the code quality is what it should be or not. And you can use that in a fully integrated way. So thumbs up for SCA. The cons, of course, like anything else, there may be some FPs, some false positives. You might have to tune these down if there's certain things that are being reported that aren't important to you. Also, of course, there's, you know, all of these tools have the possibility for false negatives as well. Again, this technique in particular is really just finding known vulnerabilities, starting with the, you know, sort of the low-hanging fruit. What are the problems that attackers already know about? And it's so important because why would an attacker take the time to fuzz your product or audit your code if they can just run some scanning tool and quickly find out that you're running old versions of vulnerable products that they already have exploits for? So we need to do that as defenders as well. We need to make sure that we're doing everything and more that attackers do. So what are the techniques used to do this SCA? Well, again, it can operate on source code, binaries, executables in a very black box manner, and it slices and dices that open. So we're going to look inside your product and find strings to identify versions of products, but we're going to go deeper than that. There could be algorithmic patterns, certain math loops that are indicative of certain types of cryptography, for example. Other artifacts like, you know, commonly pasted snippets of code that might be in your product that you might not even be aware of, those, all of those proprietary algorithms come together to make SCA something that gives you this bill of materials, and now you have novel insights in your products like never before. For example, you might not have even realized your product is more bloated than it needs to be. It's larger than it should be. It includes components that it doesn't need anymore. Maybe you can, instead of managing those, maybe you can chop those right out. That would be a great place to reduce your attack surface. And of course, we track the vulnerabilities as they come out, as these CVEs are reported and hit the internet. Basically, we'll find out about it as well. So what does a report look like? Well, a report would look something like this image here, where we scan our product and we find out that of the 34 components, for example, 17 are clean, 17 have some problems. Of those ones that had problems, we see that some of those problems are critical. Maybe some aren't as critical, so that helps us prioritize how we fix and update those if there's a need to really cut that up. Also, we get insight in the type of licensing that our product needs to adhere to based on the products that we pulled in, and that's a very important legal thing that we need to take care of. So the summary is, we want to be able to determine the risks of our fully finished products, and composition analysis gives us a way to do that. so that we can build safer software, we can be better informed purchasers, we can find the exposures that might be in our products, and we can maintain legal best practices, which obviously maximizes our ROI.